friends. So without much ado, we will be starting with Paradise Lost. Okay, so I think you have the text with you, I suppose. So you need to have your pen and paper along with you because we need to write down something before we go into the text Paradise Lost. Okay, now Paradise Lost is actually an epic written by Milton. The point that I am trying to make is Paradise Lost, the restoration age in England. This was the time when Paradise Lost was being written. And the interesting part of this is that Milton went blind while writing Paradise Lost. So it is an epic initially written into 10 books. And later, two more books were added to it to make it 12. Because in order for a book to qualify as an epic, you need 12 books. But initially, Paradise Lost was written into 10 books. And later, two books were added to it so that the tally goes to 12 and it becomes an epic of sorts. Okay. Now, before we move into what Paradise Lost is all about, we need to write down what an epic is. So, this is why I told you to have your pen and paper along with you. What is an epic? Okay, so the point is, write it down. You need to write this down. An epic has been generally described. An epic has been generally described. An epic has been generally described as a long narrative poem. An epic has been generally described as a long narrative poem on a grand scale, long narrative poem on a grand scale about the deeds of warriors and heroes, about the deeds of warriors and heroes, kings and gods. I repeat the sentence once again. An epic has generally been described as a long narrative poem on a grand scale about the deeds of warriors and heroes, kings and gods. I think the sentence is very simple enough for us to understand what the content of an epic ought to be or is. Full stop. Continue. It is majestic. Both in theme and style. It is majestic both in theme and style. It is majestic both in theme and style. Full stop. It is a polygonal. Polygonal, G-O-N-A-L. It is a polygonal heroic story. It is a polygonal heroic story. Polygonal heroic story. Now, if you ask me what do you mean by polygonal means you have various angles to see a particular hero of an epic. Polygonal. Okay? It is a polygonal heroic story incorporating myth, M-Y-T-H, myth, legend, folk tale, comma, religion and historical events of national historical events of national or universal significance comma, involving action of broad sweep, involving action of broad sweep, involving actions of broad sweep, 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 and grandeur, GRANDEUR, and grandeur. Okay, and grandeur. These are some of the features that we have of an epic. This is, in fact, the definition of an epic that we have gone through. Epic should be something very majestic, something very lofty, something very grand kind of a thing. They are not satisfied with common ordinary lives. They are satisfied with something coming out of the myths, something coming out of the oral stories, something coming about the heroes. And you have to remember that epic is about oral stories, because epics can actually be divided into two parts. The first one is the primary epic, and the second is the secondary epic. Primary epics and secondary epics, of which I think we had a little idea when we were in our semester one. During semester one, I suppose we dealt with primary and secondary epic. Primary epics are those epics which were transmitted orally and not written down. Initially, it was not written down, they were transmitted orally, and then they reached us, and then we started writing about it. And secondary epics were actually, in fact, secondary epics are also known as literary epics, because they were written first and then transmitted to different areas, lands. In fact, if you ask me what are the examples of primary and secondary epic, then I would rather say that primary epics are Homer's Iliad and Odyssey. You have another epic called Gilgamesh. These are all primary epics. And if you go for secondary epic, so the first name of a secondary epic is Paradise Lost. In fact, Paradise Lost is the first Christian epic to be written. It is the first Christian. It is the first Christian epic. Shrestha eta imponi ইম্পনিগোনাল নয়, এটা হচ্ছে লেখো, এটা হচ্ছে ইট ইজ এ পলিগ্লোনাল, POLY, পলি গ্লোনাল, গোনাল, GONAL, পলি গোনাল, ইম্পনিগোনাল নয়, ঠিক আছে, পলিগ্লোনাল, আমি আমি আর টাং টুইস্টার হয়ে যাচ্ছে, পলিগোনাল, ঠিক আছে, ওকে, সো নাও নেক্সট উই মুভ অন টু দ্য ক্যারেক্টারিস্টিক্স অফ অ্যান এপিক. We will write it down one by one. The heading will be characteristics of an epic. Now, what are the characteristics of an epic? Point number one, to make your understanding more clear about it. So, point number one, the first characteristic, ei bhabe likho, the first characteristic of an epic is its bulky size. The first characteristic of an epic is its bulky size. Obviously, as we were discussing earlier, bulky size, when we talk of bulky size, as I told you, the book was initially written into 10 books. It was actually written into 10 books, which was later remodified, and two more books were added to the tally of 10, making it 12. So it's a bulky book, because if you go through book one, you will find there are around 782 lines, around 800 lines in book one. So you can think of book two, book three, book four. If each and every book has 700, 800, 900 lines, so it's quite bulky. Okay, it's quite bulky. So the first and foremost characteristic of an epic is its bulky size. Okay, now we move on to the second characteristic feature. Okay, the second feature of an epic is the fact, the second characteristic feature of an epic is the fact that it dwells upon, the achievements, it dwells upon the achievements of a historical or traditional hero. It dwells upon the achievements of a historical or a traditional hero. ঠিক আছে, ইট ডুয়েলস অপন দ্য অ্যাচিভমেন্ট অফ এ হিস্টোরিক্যাল অর ট্রেডিশনাল হিরো, মানে ইচ অ্যান্ড এভরি এপিক উই হ্যাভ রেড ইলিয়াড অ্যান্ড উই নো ভেরি ওয়েল দ্যাট অ্যাকিলেস অ্যান্ড অ্যাগামেমনন'স ব্রেভারি অর ভ্যালর হ্যাজ বিন কোয়াইট রেসপেক্টেড ইন ইলিয়াড, দে ওয়্যার ভেরি কারেজিয়াস পিপল, ভ্যালোরাস পিপল দ্যাট উই হ্যাড। সো দিস ইজ ওয়ান অফ দ্য ক্যারেক্টার, দিস ইজ দ্য সেকেন্ড ক্যারেক্টারিস্টিক ফিচার অফ থার্ড ক্যারেক্টারিস্টিক ফিচার অফ অ্যান এপিক ইজ এক্সাজারেশন। The third characteristic feature, the second feature of an epic is the fact that it dwells upon the achievements of a historical or a traditional hero. This was the second point that I told you. The third point is exaggeration is also an important part of an epic. Exaggeration is an important. Okay, now what do you mean by exaggeration? In fact, most of us sitting here are human beings and we have this tendency to exaggerate. We have this tendency to exaggerate and we have this tendency to exaggerate. हम लोग मसाला लगाना हम लोगों को काफी पसंद है. Okay, so exaggeration हम लोग किसी भी बात को बढ़ा चढ़ा के बोलते हैं. एग्जैजरेट करके बोलते हैं, तो एपिक इज ऑल अबाउट एग्जैजरेशन। ओके, एग्जैजरेशन इज ऑल्सो एन इंपॉर्टेंट पार्ट ऑफ एन एपिक। पॉइंट नंबर फोर, पॉइंट नंबर फोर, सुपर नेचुरलिज्म इज द फोर्थ कैरेक्टरिस्टिक फीचर ऑफ एन एपिक। सुपर नेचुरलिज्म माने ईच एंड एवरी एपिक विल हैव अ सुपर नेचुरल kind of a element in it. If you go through Paradise Lost, we will have some supernatural occurrences here. Supernatural in a sense, something that is beyond natural. Beyond natural, that is supernatural. So while we discuss supernatural thing, I think we have the Wi-Fi connectivity on. So give me a second so that I can connect my phone with the Wi-Fi network. Okay, so I hope you people are there. I am back with it. Achha. So the next feature was, as I told you, supernaturalism is the fourth feature of an epic. Supernaturalism is the fourth feature of an epic. Now we move on to the next feature of an epic. Morality. Morality is the key characteristic of an epic. Morality, morality, morality is the key characteristic of an epic. Morality is the key characteristic of an epic. Now, what do you mean by a morality? Morality, by morality we mean the sense of right and wrong. What is right, what is wrong? That is what morality is all about. And epics actually carry a sense of morality with them. What is right, what is wrong is something that each and every epic tells us. Paradise Lost will also tell us something. Okay. The next feature of an epic is invocation to the muse. The next feature of an epic is invocation to the muse. Invocation to the muse. Now, what do you mean by the term invocation? Invocation means to invoke someone, to request someone. Achha, why will they request someone and whom are they actually requesting? The point is this, during the Greek period or the classical period, as we say, during the classical period, it was an accustomed kind of a fashion that before writing an epic, you need to pray to a muse. You need to pray to a particular goddess, to a muse, the muse of poetry. Okay? Muse means a kind of a goddess because in Greek mythology there are nine muses and each and every muse is connected to a particular subject. So if I am a literature, if I am a poet, I will request the muse of poetry who will help me in writing it. So invocation means to invoke someone. To invoke someone, to request someone so that I can write my epic poem. And the muse will actually give her blessings to me. Okay. So invocation is very important. And the last feature that we need to discuss here is the use of epic simile. The use of epic simile. The use of epic simile. Now, you need to break the two words epic and simile in order to understand. In order to understand. What is a simile? What is a simile? Simile is actually a figure of speech. Simile is a figure of speech. Now, in which there is a comparison. Suppose if I say that camel is like the ship of desert. Camel is like the ship of desert. Now, here there is a comparison. Camel is being compared to a ship, SHIP. Camel is compared to a ship. And in this comparison, we also have like, LIKE. So what is a simile? A simile is an explicit comparison. And that comparison is connected with either like, LIKE, or as, AS. That is actually a simile. So simile is a comparison. Camel is like the ship of desert. That is a simile. Now, what do you mean by epic simile? Epic simile is also a comparison, but since it is an epic and the length of epic is quite huge, it is bulky in size, so you have enough scope to elongate your simile. In our cases, we use a single sentence. Camel is like the ship of desert because we don't have enough time to deal with long sentences. We live in an age of technology where, while I am taking this class, most of you are busy with your WhatsApp and Facebook. Some of you are seriously looking at this particular lecture. Okay? We don't have time. We can't concentrate more than 40 minutes on a particular thing. And it is a scientific fact, we can't concentrate. 40 minutes are pori, we tend to deviate from these particular things. But in an epic, since you have a huge scope, so why not elongate that particular simile? You need to. Otherwise, what will you write? So use of epic simile. Epic simile, simile means a comparison, and since it is an epic, it will be a elongated kind of a simile which will not end in a single line. it will be carried forth into the fourth to fifth lines. There will be five lines of comparison, a single comparison elongated to five lines, since you have ample scope for that. Okay, so as I told you, epics can actually be divided into two types, primary epic and secondary epic. Epic will start with an invocation. And what is that invocation? Invocation means I am requesting the muse to actually help me write an epic. I think without much ado, it's better, since this concept of epic has been taught to you in semester one also. I have given you some of the basic characteristic features of an epic. So we will move right to the text so that we can cover a bit of invocation today. So have your text along with you so that we can cover it line by line. Okay. So we can divide Paradise Lost, Book One. We have Book One in our syllabus, whether be it Barashat University or Calcutta or Kalyani University. We have Book One in our syllabus, so we don't need to worry. In fact, there are 798 lines most probably in Book One. It will take a long time to cover this particular text, but we will jump certain sections of it which are very important, which are not that important. We will deal with just the important sections of this particular text. Okay, so let me tell you, Paradise Lost can be divided. Book One can be divided into five sections. Okay, so the first section, that means lines 1 to 26, the first section, that is line 1 to 26, deals with the invocation. So we need to write it down. The first section deals with invocation, that is line number 1 to 26. The second section, that starts with line number 27 to 298. From 27 to 298 is an introduction to Saturn and Beelzebub, is an introduction to Saturn and Beelzebub, introduction to Saturn and Beelzebub. Now, these two are the central characters of Paradise Lost. So, line number 27 to 298 is actually a description of Saturn as well as Beelzebub. Okay. To 587 deals with Saturn's encouraging other fallen angels. Saturn encouraging other fallen angels. Saturn